Thank you for being here. We're heading into the fourth week of a series that we've started here called Daniel, Learning to Live Among the Lions. Have you enjoyed this series so far?
Yes.
Awesome. Six of you, thank you very much. I appreciate that encouragement today. This series has been very powerful to me in my own personal life, and I am grateful that God has given this to me and what he's done for me and in me. But again, as I kind of alluded to at the beginning of this message, today's message is being preached under great protest, just so you all understand. All right? I'm going to get to that in just a minute, but I'll retrace my steps. The very beginning of this series, we talked to you about how we wanted to give you this idea about Daniel and talk about Daniel in maybe a different way than you've ever heard Daniel talked about. Most of us are familiar, if we have any church in our background or our histories, we equate Daniel with the lion's den or his buddies, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. And those are great stories. But let me tell you something about the book of Daniel. It is not an adventure story in any way, shape, or form. Those guys in those situations, they are not the examples, all right, of what it means to follow Jesus. They are hardcore demonstrations, but they are actually the exemptions because of what God had done in and through them. Literally, in case you didn't know this, the book of Daniel was written more per se as a blueprint of what following Jesus would probably look like in your life. And you might not get out of the lion's den alive. You might not escape the fiery furnace without being burned, okay? And it's a beautiful blueprint for what we need to look at in our lives and in our culture that we're in, because I think as followers of Jesus, we've all would agree that, man, culture just seems to be rotting. It's just like, what is going on? And it seems like sometimes as believers in Jesus, followers of Jesus, that we seem to be somewhat kind of losing our impact in culture, where literally 25, 30 years ago, people would turn to the church as the voice of reason, as the voice of truth. And now it's kind of turning. And we're wondering, why is that? And it's difficult. And literally the book of Daniel is a blueprint, a beautiful map, per se, of how you are to navigate through difficult, hard, horrendous moments in your life, cultures that surround us, and even difficult, evil, and wicked people that may be in your life that may oppose you or stand in front of you for no reason whatsoever. How are we to respond to them? And the book of Daniel is incredible. And the main idea that we talked about in the first week was this, that Daniel remained steadfast to one thing that you need to remember as well, regardless of what is going on around you, how wicked and evil it may be. Daniel always believed that God was in control of who was in control. Amen. I'm going to say that again because some of you are a little slow this morning, second service. So I'm going to say it again, give you a chance to amen, okay? We amen. We get back to our Baptist roots here a little bit when we say amen, okay? So God, Daniel always believed that God was in control of who was in control.
Amen.
That big foundation point that first week was this, guys, no matter what you're going through, and I am not downplaying or being insensitive, I have heard the stories. Some of you, I've heard your story, and I cannot believe where it's been, and even that you're like a grace story today. It's like, wow, only God, right? Only God. But here's the thing that's amazing. God is in everything. God is in everything, and God allows everything. And if you are in a wicked, evil, I mean horrible situation, you must remember that God has allowed that to happen. A lot of times, just like Daniel, we'll get caught in the backwash of the evilness around us and the evil people around us. But let's be real, right? A lot of times we're in the surroundings we're in because of the choices that we've made. And even in both circumstances, God has allowed that to happen. So our perspective has to change. So that means that we're about ready to go into war. So how do we wage war the right way? And we talked about that in the second week. And the kind of the big idea of that second week is this. Is you got to remember that God will never send you into battle until he prepares you for battle. Okay? And that is a promise from God. He will always prepare us for battle before he sends us into battle. But we have to once again change our perspective on that whole concept of that war that we're going into. It has to change. Remember what we said, like God always disciplines his children first before he brings judgment on wicked. That's why we answer that question of why does God sometimes let the bad guys win? Probably to get your attention for some way, shape, or form. And guys, we're talking evil. Personification of evil was the Babylonians when he let the Babylonians come in and conquer Israel. At the end of times, at the end of times, heavens will declare at how evil it has become, and it will use Babylon as kind of its reference point because it's so, so bad and so evil. And God does that to get our attention, to get our attention in some way, shape, or form. So last week, we began to talk about the three primary attributes that you and I can learn and take away from Daniel to apply to our lives in some way, shape, or form to prepare us to not only survive in whatever culture we're in and however bad the environment is or however wicked the situation or people are in our lives or the opposition that's in front of us, the three attributes that Daniel never stopped exuding. It allowed him to not just survive in his surroundings because God has not called you to be a survivor. He's called you to be a thriver, okay? I've come to give you life what? Just life? No, life more what? Abundantly, okay? So God wants you to thrive, not just survive. And we talked about three key attributes that Daniel continued over and over and over and over throughout his life exuded. The first one was hope. And we talked last week about the very first foundation, a biblical hope, an equated idea to a biblical faith, not a faith in, I hope this is gonna work out. I think there's a pretty good chance that God's gonna come and sort this out. No. That is what most of our faith is basically identified with. Do you realize that? Because the moment that hell breaks loose in your life, you bolt, right? The moment you hear something that this guy says from the stage, you get mad and you disappear for 3 months. When all I'm trying to do is just tell you what truth is. But the moment things get hard, this is the testimony of whether or not you have real, genuine, biblical hope that Daniel had. When all hell breaks loose, you get ready for war because your biblical faith is not based on a hope or wishful thinking. It is based on like fact, mathematical equation fact. 2 + 2 = 4. Some of you are very slow today. I'm worried about that. 2 + 2 = 4, right? That is a mathematical fact. So having a genuine biblical hope means I know at some point, in some way, shape, or form, God is going to show up and show off. Amen. Guaranteed, I guarantee it. I used my wife in the first service, right? She suffered from kidney stones for years and years and years. 300 plus kidney stones she's passed in her life. Who's passed a kidney stone in your life? Anybody want to praise Jesus about that kidney stone? Praise Jesus. I love that kidney. No. You know what's going on. Whether or not God decides to show up in this life or the next, her biblical hope is this. She will be healed someday. Whether it's here or there, she will be healed. And God will win. He will show up and he will show off. That is the type of hope that you believe. So last week, what was the biblical hope, the biblical faith, the concept? Daniel, he just like, hey, listen. Daniel's like, this may cost me. I'm going into the lion's den, and I may die. But I know for a fact, even if I die, God's going to win. He will turn this circumstance, no matter how tragic it is, he will turn it into his good and his glory. See, this is why this series is so like, oh, this series sucks because it changes my whole idea and perception of how I'm supposed to live sometimes and how we choose to live. But this is what Daniel is all about. And I'm telling you, oh my gosh, friends, if you could just change your thinking, some of us just a little bit, what might be different in your life? How things might change in your life. Just a little tweak here or a little tweak there. Okay, so now we're to the point in which I'm mad at God. I'm mad at God because he has asked me to speak on the second attribute that I do not like very well. Humility. Don't say amen. When God said we've got to talk about this because this is the second hour, I ain't doing it. I am not doing this, God. No, you are going to do this, Josh, and you're gonna say, no, I'm not. Can we not just go hope and wisdom and I'll fill her in, and you know, week number three or four. I am not doing this because here's why. Because you're like, why aren't you doing that? Because I know this is a shock to you, because some of you, you know, I'm your pastor and that's pretty cool and everything like that. But I'm sorry. I'm not very humble. It's supposed to be a joke. You're supposed to laugh at that. Thank you very much. What's that? John said, tell truth. X amened in the first service. This is ridiculous. Some of you are being very, okay. You need a little humility, and I'm praying for both of you right now, Jesus. Okay, there we go. Listen, I am not that humble. And this is a hard thing. And have you ever had that person come up to you and tell you something very truthful about you? And you're just like, you need to shut your face right now. You know what I'm saying, right? Right? But hey, listen, but what they said is true. Can I get a hand raise? Like, they came to your face and you're like, I did not like what they said, but what they said is true, right? And then what do you want to do? You want to punch them in the freaking throat as hard as you can when you're done. Okay, so listen, I'm just being honest and fair with you today. This is how I felt when God came to me with, and you're like, you want to punch God in the throat? Yes, I did. I'm being honest. I'm being vulnerable. I'm mad at God because he's making me talk about something that I don't want. So from this point on, I just want you all ready to know, okay? I'm preaching this under protest today, okay? Okay, just want you to know. And God knows this, But what he has showed me in this particular week, this week has ministered to me more than anything else, and I believe it has the potential with many of you as well. So I want you to get ready to go for a ride today. And you're like, you're just now starting. That's right. We're about 15 minutes in and my intro is done. So get ready and buckle up. We're going to go for a while today. Hope, humility, and wisdom. This particular area is, I think, where most of us abandon our walk with Christ or our faithfulness to Christ more than anywhere else. Let's face it. Hope is where we start. We have no relationship with God unless we have a simple, basic faith in God. And then that faith builds. But then humility is where we actually grow with God. And then wisdom is what we show from God. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. And that's why it's this process. And this is where Daniel just exuded. It's like, if you ever want to know where you're at in your walk with Christ, just take a look at Daniel. It will blow your mind. The reality is Daniel's hope, the first foundation, it's what gave him courage. But it was Daniel's remarkable humility that continually showed him favor with his enemies. That showed him favor with his captors. And in order for you and me to live among the lions, let's face the fact, we need not just hope and not just humility. We need a healthy dose of both of these. If we ever want to have a story to tell, which is our wisdom. If we ever want to have that. Courage, listen friends, courage without humility will lead to martyrdom. All right? But humility without courage will lead to cowardice. But together, friends, courage and humility married together, they can literally shake the foundations of hell. Amen. I mean, literally, like, advance the kingdom of God in such a way that you're like, there is no way that God should be showing up and showing off in this situation. In the most unlikely of places, in your Babylon, when you are being surrounded by lions, that is what hope and that is what humility can do. It can change the environment. So that means this, whatever the hell you may be going through, if you could learn how to tap into a little more hope and a little more humility, things literally could change. Now, again, I'm not giving you the secret formula, say in a week, they're gonna be different. I'm not gonna say that. Because many of us have lived this path and we realize it could take a year, it could take 2 years, it could take 5 years, it could take 10 years, it could take a lifetime. But we've already proven the fact that, right? God will always win. God always wins. No matter what, he always wins. But you got to understand, he wins according to how he wants to win, not how you want him to win. So you have to grab a hold of this. And the path of humility, I'm just being honest, the path of humility is the path that many of us struggle today, and sometimes we really resist following it. When I was a boy, I put together, you know, like this list of things that I wanted to be when I grew up and things that I wanted to be. And there were some cool ideas and stuff. But I'll tell you this, on that list, humility was not found. Because most of the things that I wanted to become, I realized those people aren't very humble people. Now, but reality is as a little kid, I'm like, I don't want to grow up and be humble. I don't want to grow up and be identified as a humble person. I want to be somebody that's confident, right? And the reason is because a lot of our modern day definitions of humility are off base. They're off base. Some of the modern day definitions of humility are those that are out there, like low self-esteem. A person that's humble, they must lack self-esteem because they're so shy and timid, right? So they're a humble person. They lack self-esteem. Or maybe lack of ambition. Lack of ambition. Or maybe this one, which is a big time, but the downplaying of accomplishments. These are some of the modern day definitions of humility. And guys, let me just tell you, these are not biblical definitions of humility. These should not even be identified with the word and concept of humility. So today, before we really jump in, you kind of got to erase your memory banks of what you think or equate humility to be. Because it's not self-esteem under any circumstance. Biblical humility is not synonymous with low self-esteem. The Bible actually commands us. It commands us. Did you know this? It commands us to have an accurate assessment of our strengths and our weaknesses. We are supposed to know what we are good at and what we are not so good at. Now, of course, we know this. We're not supposed to think of ourselves too highly, but somebody needs to hear this. You're also not to think of yourself too poorly either. We're to gauge our gifts. We're to gauge our abilities, our strengths, our weaknesses with sound and sober judgment. Bible confirms this. Romans chapter 12 says, "For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith that God has distributed to each of you." Galatians chapter 6, 3-4 says, "If anyone thinks they are something and they are not, you're just deceiving yourselves. So how do I know what I am?" Well, you should test, it says. Test your own actions. And then take pride in your actions only. This is why I've always said it. I can tell where you're at with Jesus. We can go in and see what your strengths and weaknesses are. You produce some fruit. You produce some fruit. You will be able, you are supposed to be confident in what you're good at, the Bible says. And you're not supposed to compare yourself to anybody else. This is another problem for many of us, right? We compare ourselves to somebody else. So then what do we get? We get low self-esteem. And you're not being humble. Do you know actually you're not being humble when you do that? You're actually being disobedient by comparing yourself to somebody else. Daniel did this so good. Listen to what Daniel, you want to know how good Daniel did this? He wrote this in Daniel chapter 1, verse 4. He said, "We were young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed and quick to understand and qualified." Yes, we were qualified to serve in the king's palace. Does that sound like somebody with low self-esteem? He was giving a quick, accurate description of his assessment of who they were. It's not lack of ambition either. Biblical humility doesn't negate ambition. And we know this from Daniel's story because we know that Daniel and his buddies were what? They were ambitious. They were eager to prove that God was bigger than the God of the Babylonians. And they worked hard and they graduated at the top of their class and they worked very diligently to outperform others often. And the last thing is it's not downplaying your accomplishments either. Biblical humility does not mean that you're never supposed to tell somebody about your successes and your accomplishments. But it doesn't mean that you're supposed to refuse to take joy in them. Listen, if I was up here every week and said, hey, look at me. I'm a pastor of a church of over 1,200 people. Give me some, give me some, give me some. Right? That's pride. But does it negate the fact that I am a pastor of over 1,200 people? No. I refuse to not take joy in the fact that God has allowed us to make his name more famous in Maricopa. Here's what it basically is. Listen, biblical humility is actually the willingness to be overlooked. It doesn't insist on public honor. But that is not the same thing as recognizing it, acknowledging it, and taking joy in it when it does come. I did this often early in my early church planting days when we were more like a church plant as opposed to a church. I would always like talk about, you know, like, oh, it's all God, you know what God's doing here, praise Jesus, all that stuff. Inside me, I told you, I do not lack humility. Inside me, I'm like boasting, like, it's all me, you know what I'm saying? But I learned this from my friend Pastor Lynn up at Cornerstone. He's like, hey, listen, that's a good answer, because it is God. Without God, nothing is possible. There's no doubt. But it's God who brings the wind, but it's man who does raise the sails. See, God has chosen to use you to make his name more. Does he need you? No. But he has chosen to use you to make his name more famous. And if you don't raise the sails, guess what's happening? Where he's placed you. All there is just a strong wind. But the boat ain't going nowhere. You getting this? I hope so. Listen, we'll move forward on this. The only reason that you and I know of all the great things that Daniel did is because he wrote a book to tell us about it. Right? That's the only reason. It's like God says, hey, I like that, Daniel. That's good. Put that down. And in the end, God's like, hey, you know what? I like that so much, we're going to go ahead and include that. So we read a book about how Daniel and his buddies did it, and Daniel boasted on it. It seems like he boasted. He told us of what God gifted him with. But God used him so much. So the only reason we know is because he wrote a book about it. Are you kidding me? Apparently God was okay with putting it in the Bible. So in short, now that we know what biblical humility is not, now we're going to get mad at me. But just understand, I'm already mad at God because I have to preach this, okay? So we're on the same team here. I'm going to tell you what biblical humility really is. In a nutshell, if you're a note taker, this is what you want to write. What is biblical humility, Pastor Josh? Here it is. Ready? Serving others, period. Biblical humility is nothing more than serving others. Now, we're going to really dig into this, and you're going to be bothered by this. Trust me, because I'm bothered, and I've had to preach this already once, and I'm still bothered. Biblical humility simply means serving others and putting their needs and their interests above your own. Do you want to know if you are biblically humble? Do you care and serve others more than you care and serve yourself? It means treating others the same way as if they were like somebody important, like really, really important. Now, it doesn't mean that you become a doormat. It just means that you become a servant. And I realize when I say that right there today, that when we say something like serving others, it's so much easier said than done, isn't it? Especially when you consider some of the people that are in your life. Because see, we're going to go ahead and add on today, okay? We're going to do an add-on to what biblical humility means, serving others. All right, here's the add-on. This is why it's hard for, it's easy, it's much easier said than done. Biblical humility also means serving others in your life, wicked, evil, oppositional people in our culture that you don't like. Why are they in that public office? Why are they serving at that company? Why are they my boss? All it means this. It also means serving those who don't deserve to be served. Yes, it does. That is like one of the most prolific, theological, profound things. I didn't even have to say suck today from the stage. It means serving those who don't deserve to be served. Wow. See, here's why this is a problem, because immediately when I said this, a name or a face went in your brain. And you know who it is, and you're like, a name, a face? Dude, I got a congregation full of people in my head right now. Right? I'm talking about serving the people in our lives that we would just rather not serve. However, that actually is what biblical humility does, no matter what. It serves those who don't deserve to be served. I guess that's why they call it humility. But you see, celebrators, when we take, if we choose the path to serving others, especially those who don't necessarily deserve to be served, here's what you will often find. It will take you to a place where God's favor and his blessings abound. You're in essence traveling the path of least resistance in most situations. But to do this, you have to travel the path of the heaviest resistance. It's why many of us are Christians. I would never doubt your Christian faith or your claim to be a Christian, but I will say this bluntly, you're convenient Christians. A lot of us are convenient Christians because we will much rather choose the path of least resistance rather than the path of heaviest resistance. And guys, let me tell you, if you choose to serve others, especially those who don't deserve to be served, you are choosing the path that is completely counterintuitive to what you would normally choose. Can I do another add-on? Biblical humility doesn't just stop at serving others. It doesn't just stop at serving others who don't deserve to be served. It now goes here. Ready? This is where we kind of step out of our own world. Because now you're mad at me. You're mad at me because you're like, I got to serve this person in my life. Okay, no. Now we're going to go ahead and move into the other area in which we're going to serve, honor, and respect those in authority over us as well. Ready? And those in authority over us that might not know Jesus, it means this. It means that we will also serve God's enemies. Uh-oh. It's exactly the kind of service and humility that Daniel and his buddies had. This is so cool. Daniel had this unbelievable, unique ability to serve his captors, his wicked masters, throughout his life so well and so loyally that he actually, get this, he kept getting promoted for it. He kept getting like moved to the next level. You're climbing the corporate ladder, Daniel, because you are serving God's enemies. What? Are you kidding me? But here's what happened. With every promotion that happened, his influence in wicked, bad old Babylon grew greater and greater and greater, eventually leading two of the worst kings in Babylonian history, Nebuchadnezzar and Darius, to proclaim that Daniel's God was the only true God. Amen. Babylon, The scriptures give us a comparison. This is the personification of evil. And two of their kings, two of the most wicked of the kings, proclaimed that God was the one true God because Daniel served God's enemies. Listen, Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel chapter 4, 34 through 37, you can read it later. Nebuchadnezzar, then I praised the Most High. I honored and glorified him, his, he says him and his, referring to him in just these 13 verses, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 9 times that God is the most incredible, awesome God. Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel chapter 6, King Darius wrote this, I am telling you that the God of Daniel is the living God. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8 times. Reference to him, he, his, God. God is the high king. Can somebody just say, wow, what a dramatic change of events. From throwing Israelite men into a fiery furnace. From throwing an Israelite man into a lion's den. To praising their God Most High. Amen. How hard could this have been for Daniel? See, Daniel's entire, do I need to remind you of week one? His manhood was taken from him. He was castrated and turned into a eunuch. And what you have to understand is in biblical times, the lineage, the family lineage and heritage was everything to a Hebrew man. So in the very beginning, he had that just taken away. And he, for the rest of time, you were going to serve evil, wicked people. And in the end of two of the worst kings possible, Daniel's God is the Most High God. But here's what we do. You know what we do? I tell you this story and you're like, wow, that's so cool. Oh man, here's what we do. But Josh, here's the deal. Let's be real, right? That was then and today is today. Listen. All of us do this and we should be ashamed. But we are so tempted to dismiss the biblical stories that we read and share as the standard but not the norm. Shame on you. If you don't think that God, your God, could do the same things that he did for Daniel today, like he did back then. You want to know why you're having trouble with this whole humility thing? Because you need to go back and listen to week 3 when we talked about faith. Because that's where your faith is. You don't believe that God could show up and show off in your current circumstance. And you're saying, that's a really cool story, but it's just a reference point. It's like something that I can look back, but no. You want to talk about begging God to spank you? It's like, just go ahead. Just give me one. Please, just give me one right now. For you to doubt that the God of yesterday is still the God of today, shame on you. I am the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. That's what he said. See, here's the problem. If we took Daniel's story, just his story, right? Here's what we would do today if we saw a modern day Daniel who would serve God's enemies. Like, why are you even compromising the holiness and the power of God's name and hanging around that person? Why are you continually saying this on Facebook about that person? What are you doing? See, we would look at the modern day Daniel and we would say that he was a spiritual compromiser. And here's why. Because Christians today in the 21st century, we are far more prone to isolate rather than infiltrate. Today, we often keep our personal contact with godless leaders, little g, with wicked people in our lives, with those that are standing in opposition to us, with those that are just like constantly just making our lives hell. We try to keep our engagement and our contact with them at a minimum. And here's what we do. If and when we ever do engage, this is so true, you can't argue with me. If and when we ever do engage, we usually do it through these tactics that are kind of adversarial in our confrontation. And here's what we do. We hide behind these mechanisms called Facebook and the other social media outlets like Snapchat, where we just get our little 30-second snippet in and say, you can't say anything to me because it's gone. So there's our choices and our points of engaging, right? There's where we do it. So-called Christians today, and I'm not doubting your salvation, I promise I'm not, but so-called Christians today are doing this, and you are taking such an adversarial approach with God's enemies, with those people that you think are wicked. You're so quickly forgetting that you're a filthy sinner too, who just happens to be saved by grace. But here's the problem. We do this as a pastor. Here's my question that I often ask. Is there any wonder why the American Christian church is losing its influence in our culture today? When this is how we're responding to the adversaries of God. We're just like immediate, like, dude, come on. Come on. Instead of, come on, let's talk. Another way of saying this is this. Is if you want things to change with those horrible people in your life or the culture around us, listen, let's be honest. Hey, man, Satan's winning the game right now. I know who wins the game in the end, and I'm cool with that. But he's winning the game right now, and I'd like to make sure that my production during my playing time makes an impact. But here's what you need to understand. If you refuse to contact evil people, you will have no impact on evil people. And that's on your record, not mine. I would rather have an impact on the enemies of God rather than no contact with them. And listen, before we move to the next thought, I gotta say this. If this is so dangerous, this mindset is so dangerous, friends. Because if you don't get more careful with your approach to this, listen, you're gonna find yourselves making the same mistake as Jonah. Remember Jonah, the big fish, the whale? You're gonna make the same mistake as Jonah did. In which, listen. Jonah didn't just hate the sin of the Ninevites. He hated the Ninevites. If your passion for God ever overrides your compassion for lost people, something has gone terribly wrong, friends. Here's what I mean by that. Ready? If you come to the point in your life that you would rather see God's judgment poured out on sinners rather than God's salvation being given, let me tell you this, your heart is no longer aligned with God. And you will become much more like Jonah than you'll ever be like Daniel. So real quick, let's get through the rest of this. Let me talk to you a little bit about the byproduct of humility. Another word that we can use for humility of serving others, it would mean by demonstrating respect. R-E-S-P-E-C-T. Aretha Franklin. She just passed this week. Huh? She said it the best, man. R-E-S-P-E-C-T. This is a byproduct of humility. Now, listen. Here's where we get this wrong, okay? Because as Christians, we want to be respected by those that oppose God or oppose us. But here's where Christians have gotten this wrong. We think and view respect as a one-way street, in which is this is what's going on. I will respect you if you respect me. Listen, that's not biblical respect in any way, shape, or form. And the longer that you view respect that way, you have a skewed vision of what respect is. You respect no matter what. And when you cross the threshold of saying, I demand you respect me, and you get so consumed with that, here's what happens. You sparingly ever give respect to anybody else. So as I talk about these closing thoughts, and you know, we're going to wrap this up 30, 45 minutes or so. Okay, so listen. But as we wrap this up, I want you to think about the godless, hard, moral, breaking down society and culture that we live in. I get that. But I also want you to put this into your personal contact with people that stand in front of you in opposition of you. And I want you to evaluate how you're responding to them. See, this is where it's hard. This is where it's difficult. I mean, try to be sensitive. But this is where I'm mad at God, and I'm still telling you I'm preaching in protest today. But it means I'm going to do this no matter what or how I'm being treated. This is where this whole story of Daniel just it's got to change your perspective. Amen. It's got to just radically change how you view things, because we're asking you. Daniel's charging you. He lived it. He's saying, how about doing it a different way? You mean your way? Daniel? Many of us are, that's just too hard. So I'm going to be sensitive here, but I'm going to speak truth, okay, in these closing comments. Biblical humility offers respect to everyone, no matter who they are or what they've done to you. It's a heartfelt deference that comes with this fact that everybody, no matter how wicked, no matter how evil, no matter how opposing, no matter how just horrible they are, but all people, you recognize that all people, everybody, bears the image of God. No matter how marred their image may have become, they still were created in the image of God. So when I say respect, that's the kind of respect that Daniel and his three buddies showed towards every single person they came in contact with. Whether it was when they, this is important for you to understand too, whether it was when they just like, hey, listen, we would prefer to stick to our non-kosher diets, right? Or, hey, listen, no, we are not going to bow down to your idols. Here's the one thing that you will see. They demonstrated respect every time because they never copped an attitude about it. See, many of us, when we show respect flippantly. If we ever give respect. And these guys, they never copped an attitude. I'm telling you, it blows my mind, but Daniel and his buddies genuinely desired the best in their captors. They genuinely desired that they had their enemy's best interest at heart at all time. How else could two kings that were wicked as wicked could be praise God and claim him to be the God Most High? And it's because of this. Daniel's humble respect was always tied to his firm belief that God was in control of who was in control. It was a reality that Daniel lived by. Listen, friends, I'm gonna say something, blow somebody's mind. Somebody needs to hear this today. Daniel, stop. When I say this, I want you to think about that one person in your life that you're just like, man, if they weren't in my life would be so much better. You know exactly. Do not look at your husband or wife today. I want you to think of that one person. Gosh, life would be so much better. I want you to listen to this powerful, truthful statement from the Word of God. And this is, you're going to understand, once I say this, you're going to be like, I understand why you're protesting God today while you preach this message. Daniel wasn't respectful to Nebuchadnezzar because Nebuchadnezzar deserved it. Daniel was respectful to Nebuchadnezzar because God commanded it. You got that person still in your brains? Or are you showing me the number one sign in your head right now? You know what I'm saying? The spiritual finger of God right now at me. Because you're, listen. Being in ministry as long as I have, oh gosh, I've heard just about every excuse possible to every story. But in particular with this one, as to why, hey, listen, Josh, I hear you and all, but listen, Daniel's response to the godless masters and leaders, I'm telling you, with what's going on in my life, that would never work today. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? Once again, you're just like begging God for a spanking by saying, listen, my God's not, he may have been big enough back then for Daniel, but he's not big enough for me. Are you kidding me? Daniel was thrown into a lion's den overnight and came out unharmed. And you lost your job. And your God's not big enough? I've heard them all, and none of them make sense or are true. Because nothing in Bible times have changed today. Like we want to convince ourselves in which they have. Here's what I mean. I'm telling you, friends, gosh, this stings. This is the hardest part, but it is so true. I'm telling you, no matter how bad things may seem to get in your life, and when I say this, I'm being sensitive because some of you are going through sheer horror in your life, and I am not downplaying that. I am trying to be sensitive and compassionate, and I get it. But all I'm doing is taking your story and putting it up to other people's stories that we read about and are supposed to learn from in Scripture to put their story and say, how can I apply a little bit of Daniel in my life in this moment where I'm going through a divorce or I'm addicted to pornography or I'm addicted to alcohol or whatever, how can I put a little bit of that? I'm going through abuse, physical abuse. Listen. No matter how bad things seem to get, the path of humility and service and respect towards those hard, those wicked, those evil, those difficult people in your life that God has placed in your life or allowed in your life. The path of humility, respect, and service is always and always will be the path that God commands you to take. Look at the words of Jeremiah. He was a contemporary of Daniel. He told the Israelites, when the Israelites were like reluctant, like, we ain't serving no Babylonians. It ain't gonna happen. It ain't gonna do it. Humbly submit, no way. You know what I'm saying? Here's what Jeremiah said. Do not listen. Do not listen to your prophets, your diviners, your interpreters of dreams, your mediums, or sorcerers who tell you you shall not serve the king of Babylon. Here's why you shouldn't listen to them, because they prophesy lies to you. Think of that situation that you're in. Try to put this in. You should serve them. That's what the Bible says. And it wasn't just Jeremiah, the Apostle Peter said it too, to the Christians in the early Rome when they were surrounded by the tyrant, Nero, the emperor Nero, right? He said, submit yourselves to every human authority, whether to the emperor, to supreme authority, or to governors. For it's God's will for you to do good. Show proper respect to them. And once again, I say it again because you're hard hearing, just like the 21st century Christians are going to be hard of hearing. I'm going to say it again. Honor the emperor. You mean Nero? Yes. Honor the emperor. Nero who's dipping us in oil and lighting us on fire as street lamps? Yes. Honor the emperor. Praise Jesus. the first century Christians honored the emperor, or you and I would not be sitting here today. Because when everybody recognized Nero to be a crazy freak of nature, and the plagues and disease came to Rome, guess who were the only people that stuck around? Christians. And from there, the fame of Jesus' name spread all the way to the 21st century. Paul, oh my gosh. Paul, let everybody be subject to the governing authorities. Why? For there is no authority except which God has established. And Paul's saying once again, I know you're not listening to me, so I'm going to say it again. The authorities that exist have been established by God. I love Paul. He does this all the time. He repeats himself. Just like, you know what I'm saying? We have to repeat ourselves with our kids time and time again. I'm going to say this again until you get it right. None of them. Whoever rebels against authority is rebelling against God. Whoa. Game changer. Those who do so will bring judgment upon themselves. Do what is right, for the one in authority is God's servant for your good. What? The person that's evil and wicked in my life is God's servant for me to do good? Yes. He's giving you an opportunity to serve, respect, and show humility under the extreme circumstances. See, I'm telling you, does the story not of Daniel just like, this is blowing up some of my theories on Christianity. So it's necessary to submit to the authorities. The clarity of God's commands, listen, to humbly serve and to show respect no matter what and no matter to who. Friends, go read your Bibles. It's unmistakable. You can try to weave your way around it and get around it, but it is unmistakable. But the problem is, as Christians today, we think respect is a one-way street. I'll give it to you if you give it to me. And that's where we blow it. That's where we blow it. It seems almost as if we're putting up walls instead of tearing them down. We respect, we show humility, and we serve to no matter who and what they've done to us, because God commanded it. And I'm sorry to tell you this, you may see results in a week. You may not. You may see results in 5 years. You may not. You may see results in 25 years. You may not. But I will promise you this, you will see results even if it is in that kingdom and not this earthly kingdom. You will see results to your humility, your respect, and your serving. So let me say this, and I'm really close to done. But right about now is when we get this logical question, right? And we say, okay, Josh, I get it. If God actually commands me to do this, no matter how hard and difficult it is, no matter the circumstances, when will I get to see the results of me humbly serving and respecting people around me? When will I get to see? And this is where many of us are wrong. This is where many of us are kind of weaker in our faith, because we think that our faith, we'll base our next step of faith on what we can see, taste, touch, and feel. And that's not what faith is. Faith is taking a step when God says take a step and you can't see the step in front of you. Okay? But this is what we base on. But I want to see this happen. I want to see me get that job promotion if I treat that wicked person with honor, respect, whatever. No. That's not how it works. It's not how it works. It's very important here, in closing, ready, that you and I never replace the paradigm of persuasion with the paradigm of warfare. That means this. With that wickedness that's surrounding us, or that person in our life that just doesn't, I mean, just it's there. That means this. When we shift our focus from persuading the loss to fighting the spread of sin, that's the paradigm that I'm talking about. If and when we ever change from the precision of warfare in our approach to the wicked and ungodly people in our lives, here's what happens. When we stop trying to persuade that person softly through humble service and respect, all that stuff, and we start fighting them, all we do is stiffen them up and harden them to the gospel. That's all we do. That's all we do. I'm telling you, here's what we ultimately see. We see non-Christians not wanting anything to do with Christians, let alone become one. And that's because if they feel pressured to change, we're using warfare tactics rather than feeling engaged, which is persuasive tactics. Here's what they'll do. They'll fight back. You put a tormented cat into a corner, they're going to fight back. They're going to stiffen their necks and they're going to fight. You put me in a corner, well, I'm going to do the same thing. Like, no, you do. No. That's not how it works. That's not how it works. Because here's what happens. When people start fighting, they stop listening. All you have to do is look at your teenage children, where they go from being like this 16, 15-year-old kid, right? I'm not making reference to my son, so don't always, everybody's like looking over my son. I'm making reference to your kids. But all we have to do is look at our teenagers, right? When you stop respecting, I know you're like, they're freaking 13, I don't need to respect. No. You start showing them what respect is because you want them to learn what respect is. Now, yes, I'm not saying you're not supposed to have boundaries and, hey, you cross that line, you're going to get in trouble. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying you're going to get a whole lot further if you try to persuade rather than fight. All you're doing is putting up walls when you choose to fight. And I get it. They get on your last nerve. They get on your last nerve. But here's what they do, right? You see your 16-year-old, you know, son or daughter, and you're like, it's gone to the point of they've aggravated you so much. You're like, I ain't telling you no more. You gonna do it. You know, all this stuff. And they're just like, they become a two-year-old. La, 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 la. You want respect? You act like, no. It's one-way street, right? How many times you said that? You want respect? Then show me respect. What? Isn't that a one-way street? I'll show you respect, son, when you show me respect. That's one-way street, isn't it? But how many of us have said that? Daniel and his buddies always chose to persuade rather than fight. And we're called to do the same thing. Here's why. You need to remember this thought today, friends. Listen. Once again, picture your surroundings. The evil, ugly, wicked people, the culture that's around us, how are we ever going to make a difference in our culture, you know, or with this person, right? The focus of the New Testament is all about changing hearts. I'm going to help you here. It's not about changing governments. It's not about changing culture. It's not about changing your evil, wicked, opposing relationships. The focus of the gospel, of the New Testament, is about changing hearts. And if you were to choose to be humble, respectful, serving people that don't deserve to be served, you get a bonus. You don't just get to see a heart changed. You might actually start to see a government change and a culture change. See, we've got to change our perspectives. And here's the best way to do it. I promise I'm almost done. Listen, you got to evaluate this. Who is the real enemy? Who is the real enemy? When you take the warfare approach, you're focusing on the wrong enemy. Here's what I mean. Non-Christians are not the enemy. They are the victims of the enemy. And the last time I checked my Bible, victims need to be rescued, not destroyed. Paul said it, 2 Timothy. The Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Opponents, meaning that person in your life, that person, you know, that's standing in front of you, opposing you, they must be gently instructed. How often are you gently instructing that person that you just can't stand? the hope that God will grant them repentance. That's the end all goal. Yes. Leading them to a knowledge of the truth. That they will come to their senses. Meaning the person that is your opponent is not the real enemy. We know who the real enemy is because we wrestle not against flesh and blood. But they're my opponent. They stand in front of me. It means they are senseless. But how many times do we treat them and point out, you're senseless? And we act like we don't even have any sense and we're supposed to be the ones that have sense. So they will come to their senses and escape the trap of evil. Our goal as Christians, when we're surrounded by this wickedness and this culture that's hard, it should never, ever, ever be for us to see and wish and hope that God would pour out his judgment on them. It should always be hopeful, respectful, mindful, and prayerful that God would actually pour out his grace on them. Our primary goal, our tactics got to change. We got to move from fighting to persuading. Go read the Bible. Jesus never railed on sinners. The thing that I read about the life of Jesus always pursued sinners. Right? And he was criticized by those what? Who were supposed to have sense. Why are you hanging out with them? Because that's what I'm supposed to do. Somehow, some way, we got to learn, friends. We got to learn how to bloom where we're planted. We do. Did you know you're not here by accident? You're not in the environments that you find yourselves in by accident. Sure, some of you may have made some bad choices that got you there, but God allowed it, right? But here's what you need to always remember. God has definitely numbered your days. He's not only numbered your days, he's also preordained when and where you will spend them. And you got to believe that. So just like Daniel was assigned to Babylon, or Joseph was placed in Egypt, or the early church was surrounded in Rome, each of you have been assigned a place that you have found yourself in today. And you must find a way to do this. You must find a way to show humble service and respect to those that are ugly around you. And you must keep believing that God is in control of those who are in control. That's how you do it. Let me pray for us and we'll be done. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Guys, I know that all of your stories are unique and all of your situations are unique. And many of us are in a situation that's just like, oh gosh, it's unlike somebody else. So I will give you this. I get that many of your tasks, my tasks, all of our tasks are very ambiguous. Like, how do we go about, you know, doing this, that, whatever? But it doesn't change this fact. As a follower of Jesus, even though your task is ambiguous, you have been called to proclaim the gospel anywhere and everywhere that God has placed you or allowed you to be. And to hold out hope that no matter how wicked and evil the surroundings or people are in your life, no matter how many lions seem to keep circling around you, ready to devour you, you hold out hope that they will repent and surrender to God. Your goal as a believer in Jesus, no matter how many lions are around you, is to win them over, not wipe them out. So here's my question in closing. Here's what's next. How's that going for you? How humble are you to that person? How servant-minded are you in that situation? How respectful are you in those circumstances? Some of us need to change our tactics. Instead of avoiding and attacking, we need to start engaging. And we need to learn how to humbly serve and respect whoever God has temporarily chosen to place in a position of authority over or in relation to. So here's what that means. How is that going for you? For some of you, you may need to make a phone call today and ask for forgiveness. Or you need to forgive somebody. And some of you are like, dude, I ain't ready for that. Okay, all right, I get it. Here's what you need to do. You need to come forward today when we sing this last song. You need to get out a piece of paper. You need to hit your knees at the front. You just need to write down a name. There's your first step. I just need to write down a name. This is the person I'm struggling the most with showing humble respect and serving. God, would you show me? Would you show me how I could better respect this person? No matter how evil, wicked they are, how, God? How can I do that? Guys, I don't know what else to tell you. I know this. Ha, this is not an easy message for me. My wife is so much more selfless and so much more humble than me. And I fail at this. Everything I'm telling you, I'm just saying this is what you ought to do, and I don't do it very well. But here's what I have learned. I have learned when I have tried it, when I have slowly approached it with difficult, hard, challenging people in my life, when I have chosen rather than to punch them in the face but give them a hug, to persuade rather than wage war, I have seen that there's truth in the scripture that says a soft answer turneth away wrath. And there's truth in the scripture that says love conquers a multitude of sins. I'm not telling you that following Jesus is easy. It's the hardest thing to do in your life. And if you signed up for it, buckle up. So today I challenge you. I'm going to pray for us. We're going to sing a song. And I'm going to challenge you to come forward. We'll have some friends down the front with lanyards. They're called What's Next Counselors. They'd love to pray for you or with you if you don't know what you even need to pray for. But I'm going to just challenge you. I'm going to challenge you to take a step today. Move towards humility. Move towards respect. Move towards serving the ugly, difficult, wicked, and evil people in your life. And don't move that direction thinking you're going to get a result in a week or two. Don't put a timetable on God. Be okay with God's timetable no matter what. Jesus, thanks. Would you bless my friends today? Would you move in a mighty and a miraculous way? Give them courage. Somebody courage to take a step towards humility. It is an incredible, incredible platform to continue thriving in learning how to live among lions. Somebody today wants to do that. I pray that you give them the courage to do that. We praise you in your precious and your holy, holy, holy Son's name. And all God's people said, let's stand. Let's stand and don't be afraid to do what God has called you to do today. What's next? Come forward.